Dr. Kalyani from Team MDS Concur. In this finish line video, we'll be talking about the attached gingiva. Yeah, so since a series of videos, we have been seeing gingival topics like junctional epithelium, microscopic, macroscopic gingiva, and all that. I've also mentioned about all the various books supposed to go through. So here, as you can see, again, I've mentioned about all the various books you have to refer when it is in case of basic topics like gingiva, PDL, cementum and alveolar bone. So these are articles not supposed to be missed, like this was one more in 97 in period 2000. Those earlier volumes always had good prints of gingiva and periodontal ligament topics. So this is molecular and cell biology of gingiva. So moving on to what is attached gingiva. So as always I tell you that these are quite overlapping topics, but the core or the examiner would be looking for is always the main. The rest things you can always include as the extra components. That means you have to write about these things and the rest would be an additional part. And that's how we're going to make a beautiful index about it, like what are supposed to be written in that. So coming to attached gingiva, it is defined as a tissue between mucogingival junction and the projection on the external gingival surface of the most apical portion of the gingival sulcus or the periodontal pocket. So that is about the attached gingiva. It's a firm and resilient structure. The width of attached gingiva is genetically predetermined. And if you see that, our AAP has defined it as a portion of the gingiva extending from the base of gingival crevice to the mucogingival line. It is firm, dense, tippled and tightly bound to the underlying periosteum, tooth and bone. Okay, then the attached gingiva is that the gingiva extending from free margin of the gingiva to the mucogingival line minus the pocket or the sulcular depth measured with a thin probe in the absence of inflammation. So basically these are the various definitions given by AAP, and this is by Walter Hall. So as I told you earlier, if you're able to remember the definition, please go ahead, but if you're not, then just write it as introduction, because the statements of definition has to be as it is. Okay, so now moving on, what is one second. Okay, so attached gingiva has a center core of connective tissue which is covered by stratified squamous epithelium, which is again keratinized. So connective tissue is composed of the collagen type fibers of type 1, proteoglycans, vessels, fibroblasts, and here we see a structure where connective tissue has lamina propria of two layers, out of one which is papillary layer and one it is reticular layer. Yeah, loosely present papillary and thick fibers called reticular. So let's see what are the ground substances composed of. Basically, ground substance is something that fills the space between cells and fiber. It is amorphous. It has a high water content. They are proteoglycans, which are major part of ground substance, which is mostly hyaluronic acid, chondroitin sulfate. Glycoproteins are present. This is one more important component, which is made up of fibronectin. Okay, so how are the methods to assess? Very important. So before you speak about adequate, inadequate, what is it? You have to have a methods. Like it's Schiller's iodine method, and luckily Lang and Lowe are the people who have given us, and they are quite easy to remember. Yeah, it is how it is done. It stains the mucogingival junction differently because of the internal composition of alveolar mucosa and the attached gingiva. That's how you discover where mucogingival junction is, and that's how you see what is the distance. Coming to local anesthesia technique, into the alveolar mucosa and the attached gingiva, you inject the local anesthesia. Then when you inject it, it swells up and the elastic, because of the presence of this elastic fibers. So that's blanching effect in the attached gingiva. Then you have this jiggling method, which you have been learning since ages, that you have to have a roll method. That's a jiggling method. Place the blunt end of an instrument over the alveolar mucosa and roll or jiggle coronally. That's you have to move it. So basically you know that the alveolar mucosa move and attached gingiva doesn't. So you can, that's how differentiate where your mucogingival junction is lying. The radiographic method is given by Terrari and Animo. So coming back, I tell you the radiographic method is like how means. You need to put specifically say some this thing like a thin ortho wire kind of a wire over the sulcus, and then you have to take a radiograph and examine how is the mucogingival junction. That's not at all a commonly done method. So width of attached gingiva is important to mention that width and thickness as given in Boyer's, that the greatest in case of maxillary incisor and mandibular incisor areas, and it is least in the premolar areas. So the factors affecting the width of attached gingiva are: width is known to increase with age and supraerupted teeth. Modifications at the coronal and mucogingival junction is stationary. Recurrent inflammations are seen. These are all the factors. Then dehiscences and fenestrations could also affect the width of attached gingiva. Similarly, high frenal attachment with the pull test you're supposed to see. Then you have recessions. Then you have tooth position or malpositions. Then the transition from the deciduous dentition to permanent dentition. Okay. So for many years, the presence of adequate zone of gingiva was considered critical for maintenance of marginal health and preservation of continuous loss of connective tissue attachment. So all these of authors had good contribution. Very, very important. As all of you know, there's a Cohen book of Atlas where that same Cohen and Goldman have traced that there's a tissue barrier concept that they postulated that this particular dense collagenous band of connective tissue retards or obstructs the spread of inflammation better than the loose fiber. So that's how it's a tissue barrier concept. So they recommend increasing the zone of keratinized attached tissue to achieve an adequate tissue barrier, thus limiting the recession as a result of inflammation. So this particular thing you need to write who all are these authors who are supporting these statements, who are all against it. Now this they told these are various problems when you have adequate width of attached gingiva. So these effect, so basically they are the advantages. What they mean to say is that the effective barrier is present. This is all the various postulates that these particular people have told, that it is it withstand the forces, it resists injury, it is resisted to the gingival stripping and recession. So let's see how good it is or how true it is. Now they're saying that is all the advantages. So when there is inadequate width of attached gingiva, the disadvantages is they facilitate the subgingival plaque formation resulting from mobility of the marginal tissue. They favor the attachment loss and soft tissue recession because of less resistance to apical spread of infection. So the role played by attached gingiva in the maintenance of gingival health is, as I told you, something controversial. Most of the research performed to clarify the role of attached gingiva has shown that there is basically no absolute amount of attached gingiva required. So which are the studies determining the adequate amount of attached gingiva? Please mention few of these studies. Just a second. Yes. Start from Lang and Low, 1992, this study. Then Miyasato, Griver study. Then Wenstrom and Linde have consolidated all these studies for you in this PPT. So this was a beagle dog study. He's tried to do an experiment and proven that. And so how it is concluded, it's a traditional dogma. Our older authors have told that you require so much, but it is need of an adequate width of attached gingiva or attached portion of the gingiva from preventing of attachment loss is not scientifically supported. Okay.